God unknown, He alone calls my heart to be His home. Please be seated. To the final piece of that first verse, God unknown, He alone calls my heart to be His own. It's a great sentiment that gives me hope when I read this reading from Jonah. I think any time the preacher has a chance to preach on Jonah, he or she should take advantage of it because it's such a great story. Becca heard this story in chapel on Friday, heard the story of Jonah, and tell a little different story today about this prophet who was reluctant. He did not want to go and preach repentance in Nineveh for good reason. Nineveh was a bad city. It was a bad place. It wasn't just bad, it was evil. For the people who Jonah was talking to, the people who Jonah was a part of, Nineveh was the lead city in the Assyrian Empire, who laid waste to the northern kingdom of Israel in the year 722 BC. Nineveh had such a reputation for bloodthirst and violence that its people were feared. And no one from Israel would go near it, much less go and try and preach repentance. In the book of the prophet Nahum, which came out about the same time Jonah did, written about the same time, this is what they said about Nineveh. They said, "Woe to the bloody city, all full of lies and booty, no end to the plunder. The crack of whip, the rumble of wheel, galloping horse and bounding chariot. Horsemen charging, flashing sword and glittering spear. Hosts of slain, heaps of corpses. Dead bodies without end, they stumble over the bodies. And all for the countless harlotries of the harlot, graceful and full of deadly charms, who betrays her nation with harlotries and peoples with her charms. Behold, I am against you, says the Lord of hosts, and I will lift up your skirts over your face. I will let nations look on your nakedness and kingdoms on your shame. I will throw filth at you and treat you with contempt and make you a gazing stock. And all who look on you will shrink from you and say, wasted is Nineveh. Who will bemoan her? Whence shall I seek comforters for her?" The Nineveh was not a popular place for Jonah. Needless to say, when Jonah was called by God to go and preach repentance to Nineveh, he fled. He said, not me. Even when God said, "You go and preach repentance, and if they don't repent, I will destroy them." You would think Jonah would be smart enough to say, okay, I will go, but there's no chance they're going to repent, which makes it likely that you will then destroy them, right? Instead, Jonah leaves. And now, at the story, we hear that Jonah has gone to Nineveh, has told them to repent, and guess what? They did. And God saw they repented. And God turned from God's anger and decided to spare Nineveh, which angered Jonah to no end. And Jonah is a fascinating prophet because in a lot of ways he's like us. He has an understanding of what God should do and what God shouldn't do. He also is like us in the way that he thinks he knows what God should do and how God should do it probably better than God does. I mean, how many of us have been in that boat where we say, "God, if only you would listen to me"? Every day I'm in that boat. So, the story goes on, and this idea that Jonah is so angry that Nineveh has been spared, it's really quite funny to hear him talk about God in the way that we like to talk about God. Only he doesn't do it in the happy way. You know, instead of saying, "I knew that you're a gracious God, slow to anger and full of kindness," he says, "I knew that you were a loving God, slow to anger, stupid God." Jonah is so frustrated with God because he knows what God should do. And he is confused as to why God is not doing it. And how many times do we say, "Yes, God, this is justice. Yes, God, this is mercy. Yes, God, this is compassion." Because it jives with what we think those things are. It jives with what we think is just. What we think is merciful. And when God doesn't act that way, we say, "Where is the justice? angers Jonah so much that he wants to die. And he says it three times. He says, I wish that I would just die. Take my life now. The first time he says it, it could be because he is close to Nineveh and he fears for his life. And he says, it's better that I die at the hands of these heathens than live in a world where they don't receive justice. But then he continues talking about it. He continues this thing of, I need to die now. Just kill me now. And it becomes apparent that Jonah would much rather die with the God of his own creation than live with a God whom he cannot count on for justice. He would rather die than live in a world without justice, without a just God, in his opinion. And God, you know, God says to him, is it right for you to be angry? And the Hebrew is interesting. It's translated a bunch of different ways. One of the ways in which it can be translated is, does it feel good for you to be angry? And Jonah's like, yeah, it does. It feels really good to be this angry. I'm angry at you, God, and it feels good. I like it. And he doesn't want to let go of it. How many of us are like that? How many of us get that little sliver of resentment and say, ooh, this feels nice, I'm going to pull out of this one. And we just pack it away in our backpack, pull it out later, you know, this is nice, I like this resentment. It feels good sometimes to hold on to resentment to God for imagined slights. God, you did not slay the bullies of 12th grade, and I will always hold that against you. God, she said no to my marriage proposal, and I am always going to be bitter about that. No matter how much you give me for my life, no matter what you do for me, I will always be angry about that. God, I was passed over for a promotion 7 times, even though I was the most qualified candidate. There is no justice with you. You're not a God. And we love to be that angry. We love to have those things on our shoulders, don't we? They make us feel better. They give us excuses for underperforming, right? We live with those things. They're part of ourselves. What God then does is, really, this is the joke of the story, really, is this bush, right? The bush of the world, which have just been waiting, they've been waiting to be appointed by God for these dudes. So this bush is appointed by God. God says, I appoint you, bush, to go and shield Jonah from the sun. And Jonah likes it. He says, it's hot. I need a shady spot. This is a lovely bush. He doesn't consider where it came from. Doesn't consider how it got there. It's just there. So he says, it's a lovely bush. I'm going to be here. And he goes to sleep under the bush. And then God says to the world, I appoint you to go destroy that bush. It doesn't matter why. It just happens. So the bush dies. And Jonah goes on with this last story. Oh, woe is me. I need to die now. And again, if you're not a toddler, you know what this is like. And God says to Jonah, is it right for you to be angry about the bush? Does it feel good to be angry about that bush? Yes, because nothing goes my way. The world hates me. Have you heard that before? Have you heard that in your own voice, in your own head before? Right? Nothing goes right for me. Everyone's against me. Life is so hard. And God says, you didn't plant the bush. Just there. You didn't labor for the bush. You know? I made the bush. God said, I made the bush. I made the world. This is all mine. And I get to do with it what I want. And I think it's at that point that Jonah kind of realizes this is really God. Because to this point, Jonah has been he's been disillusioned because this God that he's dealing with will not be pinned down. Jonah can't take a pin called justice and pin God down on the board. We can't take a pin called compassion and put it down on the board and pin God down and say, this is you, God. We can't build a box and put God in it. Because once we do that and God stays there, it's no longer God. It's no longer God. It becomes a God of our own creation, right? This God we cannot understand. And Jonah might have finally understood that by the end of the story. Because God says, look, I've got all these people in Nineveh, 120,000 people, and many animals too. Why wouldn't I be concerned about that? If you're so worried about this bush, shouldn't you have the same compassion for all these people? And we might say, well, no, because they disagree with me, because they believe in things differently than I do, because they want to hurt me. They want to hurt people that I love. I shouldn't have compassion on those. I should not have mercy on those people. Those people deserve justice. And that's where God stops us and says, should I not be concerned about those people? Should we not be concerned about our enemies? Should we not offer the same compassion, the same love, the same mercy, yes, even the same justice, to people with whom we differ than people whom we love? That's the challenge, right? Because that's a God we don't understand. That does not make any sense at all. And yet, this is our God. This is our God in whom our hearts call home. We know that it's God because we can't pin it down. Once we start to box in God and say, this is God and I understand how God works, you better start over. You better start over, because that ain't God. God is unknowable. And yet, we offer praise. God is ununderstandable. And yet, we seek to learn. We're always learning about God. And in that moment, we realize that the God we love, the God we follow, the God we trust, is a God that we can never truly know. But it is a God who loves us. And it is a God that will follow us and pursue us to the ends of the earth to show us that even though we cannot understand God, we can trust God. We can trust God, that God loves us, and that God will always be with us, even though we can't understand. God alone, unknown, He alone calls my heart to be His own. Amen.